There was a time, each gospel agrees on this, when Jesus of Nazareth found his way to a river. Now, it wasn't the James River. It wasn't the York River either. It was way out in the wilderness, down dirt roads and old footpaths, way out, I reckon, in New Kent County somewhere. Jesus went there to be baptized by this fellow named John, and when he got there, he found all kinds of people. He found rich people and poor people, clean and dirty people, people who everyone knew were messed up and people who everyone thought were pretty much all right, and he got in line with them. Even though his soul was perfectly clean, I don't know about his feet because it was a long walk out there, but his soul was perfectly clean, and he found them and got in line with them and said, "I'm with you," without having to say it. And he was baptized in that river. Today is about identity. Our text from Matthew even says that God claimed Jesus as his child, and the Spirit came down on him like a dove resting confidently on a farmyard fence. The Spirit rested on him. Today is about the baptism of our Lord. Today is about the baptism of Cosette and William, age 3 and 6. It's about the baptism of little Isla Jones, who arrived the day after Labor Day this last year. Today is about the baptism of Graham Larrick Stowe at the next service. God gave these children to their parents a pure gift of grace. Don't get me wrong, grace can be messy and life-altering, kind of like a newborn. God gave them to their parents and to the church, the body of Christ, so they can share in the life of God's family. Today is about their baptisms and these parents saying they want their kids to join the family of God. Imagine that, God looking at each of these children and saying in baptism today, "This is my son. This is my daughter, my beloved." As the Spirit rests on them, while oil drips onto their foreheads, and they are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. That sounds like a new identity to me. It sounds like a new family. Today is about your baptism too. Were you there for it? I think you were. Do you remember it? Do you remember, even if you don't remember, do you remember? Chances are it looked a lot like what we are about to see happen with Coco and William and Isla. People gathered around you, singing songs of God's love. The good news of Jesus was read, and some preacher tried to explain what was already clear as the water itself. Questions were asked, "Are you a follower of Jesus?" Promises made, "I am." Support was vowed, "We will." Water poured, prayers said, blessings called down. A new identity began with you that day. Today is about your baptism also. If you are not baptized, then look to the baptism of Christ and to the baptism of these children and know that you are invited to that new identity also. You're invited to look ahead this day to your baptism. We all share in one baptism of Christ. We all share in each other's baptisms. Today is about your baptism too. I heard a story recently about a young woman who had just finished college, and she went to get her first apartment and get the utilities turned on when the power company told her that she would need to pay an extra deposit due to poor credit. That's odd, she thought. She had never done anything with credit before besides some student loans in college. Being the intelligent young woman she was, she ordered a credit history, and since this was a few decades ago, she waited for the mail to come. A couple of weeks later, she went to check her mail, and her heart sank when she saw a thick manila envelope jutting out of her apartment mailbox. "That's not good," she said. She opened the envelope and burst into tears as she read of credit card after credit card in default, car loans unpaid. There were even mortgages in foreclosure. Someone had stolen her identity, and she was furious. She called her parents, and they told her to go to the police right away, file a report, and she did, but there was, in fact, little that they could do. This woman was beginning graduate studies in psychology, and she began to study identity theft more academically. She wanted to develop a profile of the kind of people who were identity thieves. What she really wanted to know was who would do this kind of thing. What lowlife made it so that she could never get a car loan, never buy a house? She wanted to know who stole her identity. About a decade and a PhD later, she got a phone call from her father, and he was upset. He had been upset a lot lately because they had recently buried her mother. Now her dad was upset at her, this time at his daughter, because he had found a copy of a credit card bill that she had neglected to pay. His daughter knew it must have been some old bill, and her dad confirmed that it was from back when her identity was stolen. But then he said, "I was just going through your mom's things, and I found this bill in a folder with a copy of your birth certificate and Social Security card." And right away, the woman realized that the person she was looking for wasn't some lowlife in some back alley as she had imagined. It wasn't a sophisticated criminal mastermind either. Her identity was stolen not by a stranger, but by somebody who was supposed to look out for her, supposed to love her. All of a sudden, 1,000 confusing memories from her childhood made sense. She remembered those whispered conversations differently now. There was manipulation and fear in them that she had never noticed before. Her identity was stolen by her own mother, by a member of her own family. I was listening to this story on a road trip several weeks ago. There's something about driving alone on the highway, at least for me, that leads me to pondering, to asking questions about the journey, about where we are going, about what we're doing here. Now, I don't mean to belittle what this woman or others have gone through, but when I heard this story of identity theft, I could not help but feel as if we've been the victims of identity theft also. As if we've been the victims of a spiritual heist ourselves. We were not created to live lives of loneliness or fear. We are created for relationship. We were not created for lives of greed. We are created for generosity. We were not created to destroy life. We were made to preserve life and to bring new life into the world. Our identities have been stolen from us too, and it wasn't some low life. It wasn't some criminal mastermind. I'm not even sure it was the fault of some fallen angel. I think we've done it to each other. And we were supposed to be one another's family. We are supposed to be each other's parents and children, brothers and sisters. But we have perpetuated lies about what we were made for. That's identity theft. And today it stops. Because today is about baptism. As we gather around the baptismal font this morning, we realize that God's solution to our identity theft is starting a new family where we can all live as sons and daughters of God. This isn't about God showing us how messed up we are as much as it's about God entering into our displacement and confusion and taking it on in Jesus Christ by showing us what it means to be a child of God. In Jesus, here's what kindness looks like. Here's what peacemaking looks like. This is what forgiveness is. Here's what love actually is. He shows us what it means to live life abundantly and fully. that God, who wonderfully created us, has even more wonderfully given us our dignity back. That is why God came among us in Jesus Christ and why he was baptized. That is why you were baptized, or if you're not, why you're invited to be baptized. And that is why we baptize Cosette and William and Isla and Graham today. You know what we say to wrap up every baptism? Do you remember those words that we say? Say them with me if you can. We receive you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified. Proclaim his resurrection. And share with us in his eternal priesthood. That sounds like a new identity to me. It sounds like a new family.